Hi guys, Wern here, Vaping Wern, and I'm back with another video today. I'm not going to be talking a lot today, face to face, but I'm going to be moving the camera down to my work desk, and I'll be doing a complete rebuild of the Fogger V2. I know the Fogger V3 is out, that's just different in terms of four air holes instead of three. And the Fogger V4 is coming out soon. That one has a sort of a bliss-like sleeve on the tank, so that'll be interesting to see. But a little background, basically, I filled up my Fogger with a tank of this. This is a solstice juice, e-juice, and this is a tangerine flavor. And the problem that I found was that even after washing the tank, the physical tank itself, the flavor was still sticking, and I was getting a very citrusy flavor on my other e-juices. So I tore it down, washed it with soap, and I decided to just open everything up and give everything a good wash with some detergent. I've dried everything out, and I'm going to reassemble it. And while I'm reassembling it, I will point out some key points where foggers tend to short out and things like that. Alright, so I'll be moving the camera down, and I'll be talking to you again in a bit. Alright guys, I've moved the camera down, and hopefully you can get a clear picture of the parts of the fogger all broken down. Now, I'll go through these parts one by one, so you get a better idea of where everything's supposed to go. And I'll start from this side, which is my left and your right. Now this of course is the AFC ring. Airflow control ring, and this goes on the bottom. This is the bottom deck itself, which I have stripped down and washed up. This of course is the chimney piece, and this is the AFC part, the airflow control part, that has three holes here. This is the top cap, and I'm using a metal tank instead of a Pyrex tank. This part goes on top of the tank. And we have some screws here. This is the positive screw, or actually the 510 screw. This is a this is actually an insulator, which I will use for the 510. Oh no, actually the positive pole. The original insulator for my fogger has already worn out and torn up, so I've been using this for quite a while. This is actually a insulator from my Agati kit, my Agati spare kit, which I had. When I put it in a few months ago, it was all white, but as you can see, after some usage, it has actually turned color. No big deal there. You know, it's still rubbery, it's still bouncy, still insulates well, but the color has changed a bit. I'm guessing from the heat of regular usage, and also from the effects of what e-liquid does, right? Okay, this is the actual positive pole, which I've taken out. You'll see also that there is some sort of a wear going on in the middle. It's made a mixture of rusting and peeling of the stainless steel sort of coating. Let's see if I can focus in. Maybe not. Again, you know, this part gets insulated. Well, actually it doesn't. This part goes through the deck. So the constant contact with e-liquid probably started to corrode the stainless steel coating. Best case scenario, of course, is to have this shiny all the time. But as you can see, definitely isn't one of the shortcomings of this atomizer, I guess. Now this part goes inside the bottom deck. And this one acts as the airflow, as well as a the positive connection. This one also has seen better days. It's starting to lose its stainless steel plating here. Okay. And this part, this is a rubber insulator that goes on the bottom of the AFC. Again, this one used to be white, but after, you know, months of leakages and just high temperatures, it has turned color a bit. Positive screws, negative screw, this goes on the poles. And that is all the parts of the fogger. Now, there is also another insulator in here, the middle pole insulator, but I've shaved off the top
because when the top is too high and it gets too close to the pole, it will start to melt. So I shaved off the top and put it inside, pushed it inside. I doubt you can see it from here, but it's put there so that the positive pole come air hole doesn't sort of touch the base and shot the whole fogger out. This is a very essential sort of insulator, because if it's not there and this pole touches, you will definitely get a shot, right? Okay, so let's start the build. First things first, we're going to put in the positive pole. So we want to insulate it so it doesn't short out the deck, and we'll just fit it in here. Now don't worry if you know it gets tight or it doesn't sort of fit in at first, and because of the way that the fogger assembles later on, it will definitely get pushed in. So right now you see the positive pole is not standing straight, but when the bottom deck is pushed in, it will force it to be straight. As long as it's well insulated, you are safe, right? And from there, we're going to put the center pole in. Now, since my sort of insulator is recessed, I want to make sure that it stays in and doesn't get pushed out when I put this in. So I have to put my finger over it. There, you see it's getting pushed out a bit now, but no biggie. Let me get a tool and just to push that back in. It doesn't matter if it comes out, you know, as long as it insulates the pole from touching the sides. The only thing is that you don't want it to come out too far, because it will melt if your coil is set too low ohms. Okay, so that's done. I'll put this insulator here. You see this cutout part here? You want to align that with the air holes so it does not block the air holes. Alright? So this goes in here, and I am aligning it so it does not block the air holes. As you can see here, the air holes are here and the cutout is there. Okay, with that in, we want to put this part in. Oh no, wait, we need to put the AFC back on, AFC ring. So let's just thread that in. Done. So thread this part into this part, and turn. Now the insulator is coming out, so I'm going to push it back in gently. I do not want this coming out too much, so I'm going to get a bigger screwdriver just to hold it down. Actually, I'm going to use a pair of tweezers. This is big enough to block the hole. And as I turn, hopefully that will hold the insulator down. Quick check. Yep, the insulator is still held down. You don't want that coming up too far. Okay, make sure that this part is nice and tight. And as I mentioned, once the bottom of the positive pole is pushed up tight, it will automatically straighten out, like so. Alright, so the positive pole is insulated, the 510 come air hole is insulated, and the next part that we need to be insulated is here, where it actually goes to your positive pole. I believe that it comes stock with some sort of O-ring inside. Let's see if it's still there. Can't really see it, but there is something there. But what I usually do is I take an O-ring from the spares kit and I add that to the screw, so it gives another added piece of insulation, just so it doesn't knock around there. Now we add this in, and you don't want to screw this down too tight. This is also another sort of a popular place that causes shorts. Okay, once it's snug, about even but not even. Okay, so we've got that in, and we've got our two poles here. let's just put the screws on. Of course, the screws start getting bitchy when I turn on the camera. Alright, we've got one in, then we'll get another in. Okay, so this is pretty much a fully assembled bottom deck. The only thing left to do is put on the chimney, like so. Put on the tank, like so. Put on the tank cover, like so. And turn on the top cap, and it's fully assembled. But what good is a fully assembled fogger if there's no coil inside, right? So the next thing we're gonna do is build a coil for the fogger. Okay, now that we've got a fully assembled bottom deck, we're gonna build a microcoil for the fogger. Now, I personally like to use 26 AWG Kanthal when I'm building a microcoil, and this is probably the most important tool when it comes to building a microcoil. And this is a screwdriver which is small enough to fit in the gutter. You might have a different opinion on what size the microcoil should be to qualify as a microcoil. I know there's even a chart out there that, you know, says if you go below this diameter then it's not a microcoil, blah blah blah, but as long as it gets the job done, that's good enough for me. So remember, I'm going to use this that fits here. I'm guessing it's about 1.5 or 1 mm. I'll measure that later, add it to the sort of description video, right? So again, I'm going to use Alien 26 AWG Kanthal. And this is because 26 Kanthal lets me get a coil of the ohms that I like. I usually run my coils at about 1 to 1.1 ohms. And 26 Kanthal lets me do that with 10 to 11 reps. I specifically like 10 to 11 reps because that means the coil starts from here, ends up here, and I sort of waste very little Kanthal making the legs to touch the posts. So with microcoils, as always, you start by going round and round the screwdriver till you get your coils all together. Again, I'm going to be going for 10 to 11 coils, reps basically, that will give you somewhere between 1.1 to 1.2 ohms. No, it might even go below 1.0 maybe. But the thing with 26 Kanthal is that it's very easy to work with. I find that I can build my microcoils relatively closely on the screwdriver itself without much problems. Of course, once the camera rolls, the problems are sure to come up. Again, so I'm almost there. Let's see, let's just count the amount of reps again. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Oh, I've gone one extra. No worries, I'll just pull one out here and we're good to go. Now you'll notice that I started the rep down to up over this way, and this allows me to have one of the legs to be below the coil. Again, I do not like the coil to be too close to the center post, or rather the air hole, because it will sort of melt out the insulator. But again, like I was saying earlier, 10 to 11 reps gives you a very nicely positioned coil which is just around the posts itself. Now I'm just figuring out how I want to wrap this. Do I want the positive here or here? I think I'll put it here. So I'll push the coil down. You see, because of the screwdriver, I can push the whole thing down. I'll just space this to my liking. Somewhere a bit further down here. Yep. And I'm going to lock the coil in place. Okay, that's good. I will lock the coil here. Pull this back. Screw the coil down. Some people like to wrap the cover around the screw. Some people don't. Personally, I don't see the need to. You know, as always, you know, these extra wraps, they do sort of add to the resistance of your coil. If you're going to wrap it around the positive or negative screw, I think it's better used if you wrap it around the coil itself. Okay, we'll push this down. Usually, you know, I cut myself a longer length of canthal so I have more space to work with. But as always, you know, once the camera rolls, then all the problems start to come up. As in, you know, I cut too short the length of canthal and whatnot. Ugh, this is embarrassing. But, okay. Push this down. Sufficiently around. We hold this back. I apologize if anything I'm doing goes out of frame, because I'm not actually looking at the camera. I'm not looking at the camera as I'm coiling. See, the big boy's tools have come up. I'm looking direct at the coil, so it might run out of frame. I apologize for that. Okay, we hold this down, give it a tug, and screw that in. Now, pro tip, you know, always use a longer piece of canthal when you are working on the fogger. You know, that allows you to have more flexibility around the coil itself. As you can see, my my leads aren't very long, so I'm having some problems screwing it down. I usually get this without the help of tools, like, you know, the plier and whatnot. But yeah, you have to work with what you have. Okay, quite happy with that. Oh, nope. See what I mean? This has come popped out, but no problem. Just a quick tug here, and we'll just screw that back down. Now, this wouldn't really happen if your leads are above the coil, you know. But again, like I said, this will leave your coil very close to the base, and that's not really good in terms of heat wise. You know, it will make your coil a bit too close to the insulator. And a lot of people don't think that's important. You know, they just say, it's alright, insulator melt, they just change. But, you know, the insulator really is one of those causes of shorting. And, you know, of course, burning rubber going into your lungs, never a good thing. Never a good thing. I'm gonna stop messing around with this and actually start adjusting the microcoil very soon. Please just bear with me a bit more. What am I talking about? This is a video, right? I have the power of video editing at my disposal. But, you know, if I get this in the next round, then I won't even bother cutting this part out. Okay, make sure that's snug and tight. And screw this in. Alright, awesome. That's that. We'll take this out. Let's just trim off the excess. Oh, where did that fly to? Okay, and we've got our not really finished microcoil. Not really finished because there are still gaps in between, and when I pulse, I will definitely get hot spots up and down there. You see, there is hot spots in between there. So very simple, just get your tweezers, press it together, pulse it again. Oh, looking good, but not tight enough for my liking. Press it together a bit more. and we'll try again. Very nice. Very nice. Okay, so we've got a nice tight microcoil glowing from the center out and back in when you let go. Let's do that again. Center out and then slowly easing back into the middle upon release. Okay, it's not really exactly on top of the air hole, so we just try and move it a bit. But the beauty of it being a micro coil is that, you know, it's a long coil. Oh boy, that's hot. And you know, that shouldn't be too bad. We'll get a very good vape from that anyway. Another point to highlight, you know, make sure that these leads are tucked in, because if the end of these leads touch this side, you will definitely get a shot. Where is my ohm meter? My ohm meter is outside. Okay, so no worries, we'll put in the cotton first. Another question I always get is, how much cotton do I use? And that is really a difficult question to answer. I've pulled myself out this bunch of cotton, which I can already feel is going to be too much. But let's just twist it a little at one end. Give that a dab of love to sharpen it up and thread it through just to see if I'm right or wrong. Okay, we've threaded one part through. Now personally, if I pull on this side and I get a lot of resistance, then the cotton is too much for me. So let's just give this a little twist and just gently pull. Okay, with the help of a twist, wow, I shall eat my words, because we were actually spot on. Okay, now no measurements, sorry. I don't really do measurements. I do a lot of things by feel. So you know, I'll be sitting there pulling a bit of cotton here and there. And okay, there you go, we've got enough cotton now. Obviously it's too long, so I'm going to trim it a bit. Let's get a bigger cutter. I'm gonna trim it about here. Again, this is all by feel, it's not really a science to it. Get that done. Turn this over and nip it up here. And yeah, it looks like quite a lot, you know. I know people tell you to put on the chimney first and then cut off the edges, but since we're working with cotton, we've got a lot of leeway on how we want it to actually sit inside the chamber. Now I find that by giving it the sort of S shape, we get to not only absorb the excess liquid that falls on the deck, but we also get to seal off the channels much nicer. So what I like to do is turn this around here, tuck this part in here, and tuck this part in here. You want to be careful not to put your cotton directly on the air hole, because if it goes directly on the air hole, then whenever you inhale, air will come in here, and when air comes in, it will hit the cotton directly and act as a straw, so it will just keep on drawing liquid in, right? So we've got the two ends here. I like to take this part out, as you can see here. Take it out, tuck this, press it in very nicely. Take the excess from the back, move it up to, you know, put a sort of layer, a thicker layer behind the gutter, behind the channel, to handle all the excess that comes in. I'll put this here. Yep, so you see, that's what I'm doing. I'm actually blocking the channel from the inside, not exactly from the outside. I'm just going to do the same for this side. You know, move it out to the channel, push that down. If it's, you know, only going halfway, I'll just pick up some from the back, push it to the front just to create a wall of cotton. Move the excess to the front and get that down here. Alright, so we're all set. You know, I'm confident 100% Wenchen Vaping Wern's guarantee that this will not flood because we have sufficiently blocked the channel here. Let's see if we can get this to focus a bit better. Oh, we have a visitor. Let's get rid of you. Okay, so I have blocked the channel here. And I have blocked the channel here with enough cotton. And this is the what the inside looks like. Let's see if this focuses. Too close. Not really focusing. But you get the idea. This is the top view. Give me a second. I'm going to give it a few dabs of e-liquid and also grab my ohmmeter. Okay, so I have grabbed my ohmmeter and I've grabbed some e-juice, which we'll be using to fill up the tank. And now we already know for a fact that this coil fires. You know, I had to adjust it on the hammer, and every time I pressed to adjust the coils, we had to, we were shown that it does work. So just a quick count again at how many coils. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. 11 coils. I am going to predict that the ohms will fall anywhere between 0.8 to 1 ohm. I know I said 1.1 ohm earlier, but a gut feeling about this screwdriver, you know, it's a bit smaller than what I usually use, and that's because the one I usually use is a flathead. This is a Phillips head. You know, it's still fit in the gutter, but who knows, right? My money is on 0.9. You know, let's give that a try. I really hope I do not have to eat my words on camera. And boom, damn it, I'm wrong, it's 0.8. Close enough, I guess. And okay, so since it's 0.8, it's even more so important that the coil is raised up a bit more than usual. When you're doing a bit higher ohms, 1.1, 1.3, you know, having it lower down doesn't really matter that much because it's not extremely hot. But once it's going sub ohm, then you know, you want to keep it away from the insulator a bit because you know it will melt the insulator. The ohms are jumping a bit. I think it's because the 510 and the pin were too close together. Let's just screw this in again. Yep, 0.8 steady. Okay, so I've got to eat my words. I was wrong. Surprise, surprise. Now, next thing we gotta do. No, we're not gonna wet it here. You've got to wet it on the hammer. Put that aside. Bring this back. Okay. Now I'm just going to give this a few drops so as not to burn the cotton out straight away. Okay, give that a few seconds to soak in a bit, and then we're gonna pulse. Nice. Okay, so remember what I told you about keeping the legs tucked in? We're just gonna push this down a bit more to ensure that it avoids any contact with the top deck. That also could cause a short. I've had my chimney light up like a lantern before because it's shorting out. Hopefully it doesn't do it this time. Yep, firing okay. So we're just gonna fill up the tank now. Here's a quick trick, you know, if you don't have a syringe, you only have a screwdriver, you can fill it up this way without without any flooding, because it doesn't force the liquid down too fast. Of course, you could always just fill the liquid this way, push this down, but with the fill screw screwed in, it will cause too much pressure and force the liquid into the chamber. So what I like to do is just open that, fill like this. You know, it can go pretty full. Okay, that's pretty full. And now when I push in this deck, I have this hole open, so some of the pressure can still escape. Please don't flood. There you go. And with that in, we put back the fill screw. And you know, you don't always carry a syringe, especially when you're out for work or something like that. You know, you don't have a bag handy. You can only pocket a screwdriver and a small bottle of e-juice. This way works perfectly fine. We'll cover that on. We'll grab the drip tip. I've been using the fogger recently with this drip tip. It is the Shorty from RSM. And there you go. Oh, let's just release this a bit. And there you go. The reassembled fogger in how many minutes? I need to check. But let's move the camera back up and have a vape.
Hi guys, it's me again. I hope that tutorial wasn't a bit too long-winded or rambly of sorts. I was trying my best, you know. Sorry if parts of it were out of focus. You know, I have to work with what I have here. But anyway, back to the start of today's video, the fogger on the hammer. And you know, I completely rebuilt this. It has a 0.8 ohm microcoil on it using cotton. First things first, let's check whether my filling method has caused it to flood. Absolutely no gurgling. Always a good sign. Let's take a vape. Wow. Very, very tasty. It's damn sweet though. You know, I checked back with my friend after the guy that got me this bottle after my review, and he was telling me that even on his bottle, you know, it's overly sweet, and he attributes that to an overly sweet batch this time around. It's still a very decent e-liquid, you know, don't get me wrong. It's still very one-dimensional, very sweet on this one. The throat hit this time, it's really there. You know, last time I ran it on a silica, but on cotton, you really feel the throat hit. And that's a bloody good vape. More importantly though, the objective of this entire breakdown was to get rid of that citrusy smell, taste, you know, that was left there, residual taste, and it's completely gone. I'm happy, really happy. You know, sometimes the main sort of culprits, if you use that word, it tends to be when you don't sort of clean the parts with detergent. Also, I found that the rubber parts, especially the O-rings insulators, they sort of retain a lot of aroma and flavor. So you want to give those a good soak, a bit of detergent as always, and in no time, you'll be having your vape back to normal. So that's the hammer. I doubt I'll be reviewing it, because personally I don't like it that much. But hey, you know, who knows. But one more vape and we're out. I hereby declare this project a success. I hope you've learned how I built my microcoils, and I hope that will help you a bit. Please excuse the sort of messy positive negative terminals. You know, things happen on camera, right? But here's me, Vaping Wern, signing out from another video. Vape on, guys.